Cerveza Tecate Born Ball, Casa México Tequila, It's in the Taste y Adriana's Insurance es para todos. Presentan este combate pactado a 4 rounds en la división de peso medio. 4 rounds of boxing in the middleweight division. Presentando sus tres jueces, your three judges scoring, Carla Cáez, Jerry Cantú y Dr. Lou Moret. And when the action begins, your third man, el tercero en la superficie, Thomas Taylor. Introducing to you first, the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing white and red. His official weight, 152.6 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina Tecate Azul, vistiendo calzoncillo blanco con rojo, con un peso de 152.6 libras. Professionally, he stands with one victory against no losses, and his victory coming by the way of knockout. Presenta un récord de una victoria, cero derrotas, y esa victoria por la vía del knockout. De Bogotá, Colombia, John León. And his opponent across the ring is standing in the red corner wearing brown and gold. His official weight, 156.6 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina Tecate Roja, diciendo calzoncillo café con oro, con un peso de 156.6 libras. Professionally, he stands with one victory and no losses. Una victoria por cero derrotas. Representando el este de Los Ángeles, California, Ángel Bojado. Y para dar las instrucciones finales, aquí está el referee. Your referee, Thomas Taylor.
Guys, trunk's good here. This is a little high, coach. A little high, so I'm gonna let him work in right here, okay? I gave you instructions in the dressing room. Protect yourselves at all times. Listen to my commands. Touch them up. Back to your corner, gentlemen.
Tom Taylor, third man in the ring. Do you see Santa Monica Pier? Steve, you got the tail of the tape?
They're both 23 years old. But once again, the big story is Angel Bojado weighed in at 156.5. Beto, just my opinion, he's probably at least 2 weight classes above where he should be.
And that 156.5 was a fight, was an agreement. We'll get into that right now. It was supposed to be lower than that. Bojado came in 4 pounds over. They told John León in the morning, hey, go have some breakfast. We're going to have to figure out a new contract. They were able to get the agreement.
Looking at Bojado, for this fight to actually take place, they probably told León to have lunch and breakfast. Jason, just looking at the body of Bojado, doesn't he just look heavy?
Yeah, without a doubt, you know, he doesn't look like your typical boxer that struggled to make his weight and, you know, that had to do a lot of dieting and sweating and cutting the water weight and everything.
Jason, what do you fight at?
I fight at 160.
Yeah. That's exactly all we have to say. And all that stuff you described, cutting weight, dropping water weight, going into the sun, I don't think any of that occurred with Bojado. And I think one thing that I've learned about really good fighters, Jason, is that boxing is not just a profession, it truly is a lifestyle, isn't it?
Yeah, you got to live the life, you know, inside and outside the ring. You got to be disciplined, and if you are disciplined, as you will know, the fighters that are disciplined outside the ring will show the discipline inside the ring as well. And, you know, this is going to be a test for both these fighters tonight, I think, because it's not often you get two 1-0 fighters fighting each other this early on in their career.
One thing that's very noticeable, guys, is León is much taller and ranger. If he establishes that jab, he could really make things easier for him on the outside just by sticking out that stick consistently.
And we don't pull any punches here on the broadcast. Angel Bojado has been on our bout sheet for during the week. Steve and I, or Doug Fisher, we get notes sent to us. Here's the bout sheet. Here's who's fighting. I believe 3 times, Steve, we've had Angel Bojado on our notes where the fight never happened. And it's not us making fun of him. It's just a matter of fact that he hasn't done his part of the job.
He is the disappearing boxer. People ask me, what weight class is he? And I just say, I don't know. He just can't wait to eat. I mean, it really is that simple. And I remember Bojado, his older brother, Panchito Bojado, represented the 2000 Mexican Olympic team in Sydney. And I thought he was as good a prospect as there was. And he started off very quickly in his pro career. And there used to be a young kid that used to shadow box into the ring with him. That used to be this young man right here, Angel Bojado. How quickly they grow up.
Heard about Bojado. I've always heard that he has talent and skills. As a matter of fact, how would he handle it as a professional? Here he is against John León, 1-0 with that one KO. from Bogota, Colombia, now living in Southern California. Stablemate of Pablo Rubio Jr., the Shark. You see his management company, Shark Sports, across his trunks. Bojado, his only fight was last year. He signed with Golden Boy almost 2 years ago.
And Jason, from right here, Bojado really can't do much, can he?
This is what I was just going to say. You know, coming into this fight, Leon's going to look at Bojado and look at this. It's a four-round fight. It's very like the amateurs. You know what I mean? He's got the height, he's got the distance, and he's got the reach. All he has to do is keep him out.
Yeah.
You know, box him, move. And Bojado won't get inside. This could be a very easy night for Leon if he wanted to do that. But you know what I mean? When a lot of fighters turn to the professional game, they think that they have to set down on their feet. They think they have to let people see their power and everything like that, but not over a four-round fight like this. You know, I think it would be very smart if Leon used his distance, used his height, and outboxed Bojado.
And we take a look at some of the action from round number one between Bojado and Leon. A round, quite frankly, Beto, I think it was very hard to give Bojado. I scored a 10-9 for John Leon, and as Jason mentioned, there's only three rounds to go. And Jason, these fights, you really have to have a sense of urgency. These things are not marathons, these are sprints.
I remember one of my fights against Mark Christopher Atkins at the Hard Rock Hotel in Vegas. It was scheduled for a 6 or 8 round fight, but whatever happened, it turned out to be a 4 round fight.
You were a swing belt.
Yeah, you know what I mean. So right away, I switched my thinking. I was like, okay, I've had over 250 amateur fights. I'm going to take this fight as an amateur fight. And I was going to get in there, start fast, catch the judges' eyes, and just make sure that there was no slips, no knockdowns, or anything like that. Because obviously in a four-round fight, one knockdown can change the whole fight. You know, so it's very important for Leon to understand that and to use his distance. And it's all about getting the one right here now tonight.
Jason, as you build up your endurance and your seasoning as a pro, is it easier to fight 10-round fights psychologically than the pressure of jamming everything into 4 rounds?
That all depends on the person themselves and on the fighter. You know, everybody's made different, of course. You know, and some people will like the quick, fast pace of 4 rounds or 3 rounds as it is now. It's 3-3s in the amateurs. And other fighters like to get into things, you know, have a bit of time to set themselves, to eye up their fighter, to feel them out and everything like that, and prefer the 10-round fight. So it really depends on the fighter themselves. But for me personally, you know, I really enjoyed the 3-3s, and I think I can adapt well now to the 10-3s or 12-3s.
That is the voice of Jason Quigley, who headlines ESPN March 23rd against Glenn Tapia. Use the hashtag RingTVLive, and we will try to get you your shout-outs. Appreciate everybody sending us tweets. They're watching us in Colombia right now. La esposa de John León, Diana, y su niño Dominic, de 3 años. También saludos a José Elias, el papá de John León. They're also watching us in Verona, as Carla Lustenau and Shauna Davis and Rob Gaspari are watching us. Golden Boy was there on Saturday for David Lemieux and Curtis Stevens. That's where Will Wright is going on the red eye tonight. And John Leon looks very comfortable in this second round.
Beto, I think he's having a very big second round. He's established the distance. Everything's been working off the jab, and he's clipped him with some very strong right hands here. I think Bojado needs to get going here. I think he's on the verge of being down 2-0.
Bojado, pro debut August 5th, 2016, went the distance against Yuri Silverio. John Sanchez Leon had a first round KO of Jose Huerta last July. That was in India. And that was a fight at 146.
And Jason, anytime John Leon just does that, sticking out even a token jab, boy, Bojado has a very tough time breaching that airspace, doesn't he?
That's exactly what I was going to say. You know, Leon had a great phase in the fight there where he was outboxing him at distance and Bojado was falling into the shots. And then as soon as he started catching him, he started pressuring the fight. Why is he pressuring the fight? He has the fight in the control of his hands. He has it at distance, and that's the way he should keep it. He doesn't want to mix it up and get in there and get caught with a silly shot that might knock him down or anything like that, or a trip. You know, he's doing it perfect as it is. There's no need to mix it up in my eyes.
And guys, I think it's 2-0, 20-18, and we are halfway through. Things I don't think are looking very good for Mr. Bojado.
ladies and gentlemen, the biggest fight of the year takes place in Las Vegas, Nevada, the T-Mobile Arena, completely sold out.
Angel Waddle, John Leon. Some highlights from the second round. What do you see, Jason?
I see Leon using his distance beautifully here. You know, this is the perfect fight right now. Right there, what he's doing is absolutely perfect. Keeping it at a distance. Bojado can't get in, and he's trying to get in. He's swinging, he's missing, and leaving himself open. You know, this is the perfect style. But look, now you see the likes of Leon. Look at him getting inside. You know, starting to swing over the top. You know, I don't think he needs to do that. He's looking for a knockout, of course, which would be great. But, you know, I think he should stick to his boxing.
Leon does not have a promoter. He's the B side. He's on the blue side. Has a manager with Meta World Peace and Pablo Rubio Sr.
And Beto, we all know that Meta World Peace loves a good fight.
Oh, yes, he does.
Malice at the Palace. Who can forget that, huh?
But Bojado, a Golden Boy fighter, so if you can go and beat one of those guys in front of Roberto Diaz, the matchmaker, and other Golden Boy brass, that opens up some eyes. These guys are hungry, especially at the Belasco. Because you fought there, guys come in trying to rip your head off because they know they can make it. You have a target on your back if you're a Golden Boy guy.
Of course, you know, and that's their perfect opportunity. And plus, you know, it's a small ring, it's a small venue, you know, it has a great atmosphere, so it can get you hyped up very quickly, you know, a few roars and shouts from the crowd, and you know, you get an extra level and an extra gear in your engine.
The voice of Jason El Animal Quigley, middleweight for Golden Boy. What's your record?
12-0 right now with 10 knockouts.
Oh, come on, say it right, 12-0 with how many knockouts?
You know it better. It's 12-0 with 10 devastating knockouts.
I told you I'm going to set you up, make you look good tonight. Doesn't sound like it's your first time on a microphone. Angel Bojado, 23 years old from East L.A. in the brown and white. John Leon with that good lather from Bogota, Colombia. Is Leon the one, the aggressor? Oh, he is with that one right
well,
hand.
Listen, when he establishes that jab, and I think Jason's right, the only way he could lose this fight is basically by hanging a curveball if he gets a little greedy on the inside, because when they're chest to chest, that's where Bojado can have success. He's not a very tall guy, doesn't have a lot of range. If they're outside, Beto, I think that John Leon can really just pick his way apart, literally using one hand, that being the left.
Veronica Vitella watching this in Montebello says, good job Quigley, I'm enjoying him. Wildcard King, Jerry Casares, nice job, fellas. Thanks to everybody watching us. Less than a minute to go in the third round. John Leon, you see the Columbia on the back. He started boxing at the age of 11, did Leon. Favorite fighters, Oscar and Tito. He said, don't ask me to choose one, though. Picking up the pace here, that he found that other gear you were talking about, Jason.
Yeah, you know, I think that's the crowd, that's the small atmosphere. And you know, I think he's doing perfect, and I think possibly he could get the stoppage if he keeps pushing the fight, but why take that risk in a four-round fight? You know, he's doing perfect, he's looking good, and that's exactly what I'm sure he wanted to do tonight in front of Golden Boy, in front of Robert Diaz.
Well, there's an old phrase, Jason, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. I think he's just steadily breaking down Bojado, and if you look now, I think there is blood coming from the nose of Bojado, so he's starting to show the effects of what's been a very steady attack, and another good right hand from Leon.
Final seconds of the third round, scheduled for four. Another good right by the Colombian Leon here at the Belasco Theater, the two-year anniversary of the LA Fight Club. Why are they shaking hands like that? You just got clocked. Why are you shaking hands?
I do not know.
Do you do that?
Hell no.
I get if you have a good scrap. If you have a good scrap, okay, good. At the Belasco, they dance club anyway. If it's Tiesto or Calvin Harris up there, cool. But you just got clocked with the right hand.
Yeah. I would be clocking him back, not shaking his hand after that.
I don't know what's being said in Bojado's corner, guys, but on my scorecard, it's 30-27. Jason, I think if you're Bojado, you have to go for broke. I think he needs a knockout to win this.
Without a doubt, but it just goes back now to making weight. Obviously, he doesn't have the discipline to make weight, as he's proven in the past.
Heard a little bit of you shoot first, you gotta be active. John Leon came to the United States a year ago chasing a boxing dream. He actually came with Oscar Negrete, Golden Boy fighter, the Colombian. He might as well be the conduit, the guy. He might be getting a little cut on all these Colombian dudes that are coming. But Leon had dreams of going to the Olympics. That felt, and as soon as that happened, when he was eliminated in one of the world competitions, he made a phone call, said, I want to go to the United States. He left behind his wife. Video chat with her every single day. And Jason, you made the same decision. Leave your family. How hard is that when the first year adjusted?
To be honest, the first few months is amazing.
Oh, really?
you're out here in L.A. and everything.
The word is freedom.
Yeah, you know, you're out here in L.A., everything looks great, and it's amazing, you know, and it's something new, it's a new experience.
Okay.
But, you know, after a while, you start to miss your family, your friends, and your local takeaways, and, you know, the simple things of life back at home. But, you know, when you have a job and you have a goal and a target for yourself, you know, that gets you by every day.
John Leon has a goal and a target. He's letting his hands go here in the fourth round. Angel Bojado trying to go with him. But his punches, there's no pop.
Well, you ever heard of the phrase marshmallows to a battleship?
No.
You just did, because this is what happens when you fight out of your weight against a guy who's naturally bigger and was actually in better shape to begin with you. Bojado's punches just don't seem to have any real effect on Leon. I think Leon's fought a pretty good fourth round here. Certainly not sitting on the lead, Jason. He seems to be pretty assertive. Hard right hands after establishing the jab.
You know, it's easy for me to say what way he should box sitting here, but I don't know what's going on with Leon. Like, he wants to come here. He wants to make a statement.
Yeah.
You know, as you says, he doesn't have a promoter. He's right here now on a Golden Boy show fighting a Golden Boy fighter with Robert Diaz sitting in front row. He obviously wants to go out there and show them that he's something special.
And we have to be honest, Bojado is quote-unquote the house fighter. My scorecard is highly unofficial. But again, another good right hand by Leon.
Yeah, you know, he's catching Bojado very comfortably, you know, especially with that backhand. And he's boxing a perfect fight here, you know what I mean? If he just keeps it nice and long now, stays out of trouble, Bojado's going to fall into his shots, and Bojado's punches.
Boy, he just looks winded. Yeah. He really does, Bojado. He looks like a guy that didn't do a day of road work coming into this bout.
Well, Steve, he had to lose weight to get to lose weight. To get to a new weight agreement. Basically, he had to lose a lot of weight to get this fight done. Sal Sanchez, the amateur out in India, watching us tonight. You don't have to worry about losing weight. He might be fighting April 1st. The younger brother of Emilio Sanchez out there with Toño and Joel Diaz, where tomorrow night, Joel's fighter, Diego De Loya, will be fighting in Verona. He's in the card to Lemieux and Stevens. A good night of action for John Sanchez Leon, fighter from Bogota, Colombia. Underdog, didn't look like it. The final seconds of the fourth round. Leon fighting above his weight class. Didn't seem to take a toll on him at all. We are done with four, and the fight is over.
I would be stunned if that young man from Colombia did not get his hand raised in victory. I don't even know if Bojado actually won a round. I thought he was in command from the very beginning. Jason, he established the jab from the outside, then he came downhill with overhand rights, and I thought he finished the fight very strong.
Without a doubt, he established the jab, which every coach should tell their boxer is the key to the door. You know what I mean? It opened everything up, and that's exactly what it did for Leon tonight. It opened up that backhand, and he landed it beautifully numerous of times in each round.
And I think this is the action from the final round where he was not sitting on his lead. I thought he put an exclamation point to what was a very solid performance, and he just seemed to be the better conditioned guy. He had a little bit more left in the gas tank, and quite frankly, Bojado really didn't show much throughout the night. Jason, if you're Bojado, it's obvious you don't have an appetite for the lifestyle or training. You begin to look for another way of making a living.
Exactly. Like, you know, Bojado, to me there as well, looking at this fight from us sitting here, we had Leon three rounds up going into the last round. You know, so Bojado, if he's a smart fighter and a smart person, he should know that he's trailing going into the last round. And to me, he didn't show the heart of a champion to come in there and to pull it back and to go for broke, you know, if that's what he really, really wants.
This isn't a team sport. You guys are with the same promoter, so you kind of take a little bit more pride when you see another Golden Boy fighter. But when you see a Golden Boy guy come up and not make weight, look sluggish, what do you think about that?
You know, that's just typically on the fighter himself. And, you know, it's disappointing on that fighter himself, because there's a lot of fighters out there that would love to be in Bojado's position, to have a promoter like Golden Boy behind them that puts on constant fights and big shows and gives you the opportunities that a lot of fighters don't have. you know, I think Bojado should have maybe took things a little more serious and appreciated what he got with Golden Boy.
There you see Cuñado in the red shirt in the corner. Carla Lusta now in Verona. The stream is now working in New York, Steve. They said it's snowing, so the stream wasn't working.
Whoa.
So hello to everybody at Golden Boy in Verona. Carla Lusta now, Rob Gaspari, and Shauna Davis,
yeah.
And everybody, and Javier Razo, the matchmaker, getting it done. Thanks for watching
My
us.
Man Razo.
And guys, don't feel bad. It was only low 80s here today. Don't worry, guys.
But it was a dry heat.
Dry. It was very dry. Very humid.
Steve Kim has his best sandals out for you guys right now. We're waiting the results. Tom Taylor is the referee. Lethal Duran, Steve Kim, and Jason Quigley. And let's see what the Twitter world is saying. Patrick Smith, I knew Jake Quigley had hands. Didn't know he had mic skills.
So these guys actually understand what I'm saying?
They do, I don't. I forgot your Irish spray. You run there, right, Griffith Park?
Yeah, beautiful, something amazing. And right there now at this time of night would be absolutely beautiful looking over the lights of L.A.
Yeah, you're not doing Mount Baldy tomorrow, are you? No, you're done.
I'm not too far out, or too close now to the fight, so I'll be back in doing my normal run on Venice Beach tomorrow morning, nice and light, fast, sharp.
What time are we doing that?
Whatever time, Beto, you know, whatever time we get in at from our night out tonight.
So, you know? I mean, we'll be in bed by 10 tonight?
Yeah, probably.
Because you live that lifestyle because you have a lot on the line.
Yeah, you know, it's just something that I'm passionate about. And, you know, I appreciate the opportunity that I've been given, you know, in my life by everyone involved, my whole team, my family, my friends, everyone that have supported me. You know, I appreciate everything that I have. And I'm really looking forward now to going out there and to proving to myself and to all my friends that the support means the world to me and going out there achieving my dreams.
Damas y caballeros, después de cuatro rounds de combate, nos vamos con las tarjetas de los jueces. After four rounds of boxing, we go to the judges' scorecards. Los tres jueces, Carla Kais, Lou Barrett, y Jerry Cantu tienen las tarjetas 39 a 37. All three judges have scored the same, 39 to 37. For your winner, by the way, of unanimous decision. Su ganador por la vía de la decisión unánime. John Leon Sanchez.
Yep. Beto, I thought it was an easy call. I thought it was obvious. Chick Hearn would have said you could have called that in Braille.
You can see the emotion on the face of John Sanchez. Leaving his country, leaving his wife, his kid, his family. He said this was a huge opportunity. He couldn't afford to lose.
Beto, I think he may have just earned himself at least another shot at the Belasco Theater, if not, perhaps, maybe even a promotional contract. I think he has some real skills here.
And Sanchez, we mentioned Golden Boy has a new feature with ESPN. A lot of fights on the Golden Boy calendar in the next couple years. And let's look at the recap of the first four rounds.
You know, this is Leon here doing what he should have done throughout the whole fight and exactly what he done. Keep it nice and long, catching him with the long shots. That jab again, look, key to the door, opening everything up and landing that backhand in over the top. You know, look, beautiful right hand, left hook, right hand again. And this is where he gets a little bit greedy, I think, and tries to go for the knockout, which, of course, would have came if he had caught him clean.
There's an old phrase, the training doesn't lie. What you do in the 6 to 8 weeks prior to the night of the fight will tell you how you're going to perform. And quite frankly, John Leon won this fight probably months before. His preparation was that much better.
Without a doubt, you know, and it can tell on a fighter, you know, by their physique. Of course, there's fighters out there. You fighter, you might know Paul McCluskey from Ireland that fought Amir Khan. You know, you look at Paul McCluskey, he was a hard trainer, he worked hard, but he never looked in shape.
Juan Diaz, the baby bull, was another example of that.
But these guys made weight, you know what I mean? This guy doesn't look to be in great shape, but you know, he's missing weight, so he proves that he is maybe being a bit lazy and not taking it as serious as he should.
Next fight coming up, super welterweight division, a guy whose body looks good, he trains hard. TKO Boxing in Santa Ana, that's Alexis Rocha taking on Long Island's Marcus Beckford. Bethel Duran, Steve Kim, and Jason Quigley. Well, we have a chance right now. Let's get to some news and notes. Steve, I want to start it off with some sad news. Legendary boxing man Lou Duva passed away this week at the age of 95, and you had some great tweets about your interaction with him.
Yeah, rest in peace to a real true boxing guy, Captain Lou Duva, the patriarch of main events, best known for heading up main events, being the trainer of the 84 Olympians that really caused a lot of history to take place within the ring. Shows at the Ice World in Totowa, New Jersey at the beginning. Company led by Dan Duva, his son, became a promotional powerhouse. And if you want to talk about some of the great training duos of all time, I would say him and George Benton, I think, are among the all-time greatest. And Lou Duva is a man that gave to the sport of boxing, did what he wanted to do, and made an incredible contribution. Rest in peace to Lou Duva.
Busy weekend of boxing, not just at the Belasco in downtown Los Angeles, the two-year anniversary of the LA Fight Club, but Saturday night, HBO, David Lemieux, Curtis Stevens, and also the return of Gamboa. And Nicaragua's always dangerous, Rene Alvarado.
Yeah, that's a guy that we've seen. I think he's going to give quality rounds to Gamboa. I think Gamboa will be too skillful. Jason, let's bring you in here. I think this fight, the main event tomorrow night in my Verona, has some implications for you. I think the winner of this fight is someone that you're going to be targeting down the line. Curtis Stevens or David Lemieux, who do you favor?
You definitely know, Kim, that I'm excited about this fight, and it's something I'm going to be watching very closely.
Haven't you sparred Lemieux?
Yes, I was in camp with Lemieux for the Triple G fight.
Oh.
You know, so I did a good few rounds with Lemieux. As I said, you know, I don't look at any fighter out there and look at him as a rival or somebody that I want to get or anything like that. You know, I'm here and my only aim and my only focus right now is Glenn Tapia come March 23rd. But at the end of the day, I'm going to have to fight other guys to get to the top and get to the level where I want to get to. And, of course, I'm looking at all other fighters also out there.
I just have concerns. I like Curtis Stevens a lot, known him for years. I'll be honest with you. When I saw him November 19th on the Kovalev Ward undercard against James De La Rosa, it was really a natural 47-54. He looked like a faded fighter. So the question becomes then, was it a bad night or was a fighter that has now gone on the other side of the hill? That's why you fight the fights, and we'll find out tomorrow.
James De La Rosa, who Jason Quigley beat. Was it last Cinco de Mayo?
Yeah, that was right. Last Cinco de Mayo, it was on the one of the Canelo cards.
Canelo Khan
undercard, correct. Yeah, you know, so James De La Rosa was one of my first big step-ups in my career. You know, I was only 10-0. The guy was 23-3, and, you know, it was a massive step-up for me, and I went the 10 rounds for the first time in my career as well, and that's kind of experience, you know, that you can't buy, especially on a big stage in Vegas. And, you know, that's going to stand by me throughout my career.
The voice of Jason Quigley, who headlines against Glenn Tapia March 23rd on ESPN. Now let's look backwards to last weekend, Steve. Thurman Garcia.
You know, it was a split decision, but I thought it was about as clear a split decision as you can have, Jason. I thought one guy was more mobile. I thought he was more active. I thought he completely outboxed him. Danny Garcia simply could not draw him into any of that left hook counterpunching that he's so known for. It was not what I'd call an exciting fight, but I do think Keith Thurman fought a very sound tactical battle.
The way that I looked at that fight and that I sum it up is that wasn't a fight for the fight fans. That was a fight for the boxers to watch. You know, the guys that are in there doing it and can respect the performance that Thurman put on. I was very, very impressed. He went out there, he let Garcia know that he meant business from day one. He landed some big heavy shots, caught him clean, put the pressure on, and then he moved and outboxed him. I thought it was an absolutely brilliant fight. And I think also throughout that fight, Garcia knew he was trailing throughout that fight. And I think it was very important that he got back into it, but I didn't see the hunger in his eyes. I didn't see the determination, the drive, the passion that he wanted that fight. I definitely seen it in Thurman. I thought Thurman definitely wanted it a lot more also.
I think there's one thing against Danny Garcia you have to do if you want to trouble him. I think you have to move. You have to be able to be very good with the jab, like Mauricio Herrera. Lamont Peterson riddled him with movement, and I thought that was a very good blend of both of those elements from Keith Thurman. I'll say this, though. I thought certainly he won that fight. He is now the unified champion. But, Jason, I still think, as faded as he is, and he's not what he was, let's say, 3-4 years ago, I think Manny Pacquiao, as long as Floyd Mayweather is indeed retired, I still think he is the world's best 147-pounder.
Without a doubt, you know, and as you said, Thurman showed that he could box and he could fight. You see a lot of fighters out there today, you know, you'll get their opponent that watches them and understands, okay, he's a come-forward fighter, or okay, he's a boxer, he likes to move. Whereas if you're going to fight Keith Thurman, you have to be ready to put him on the back foot or to be on the back foot yourself, you know. And that's what's so great about boxing, and that's why I like Keith Thurman, and that's why I respect him so much as a fighter, because he's not just one-dimensional. He can mix things up, and there's something special about him, I think.
Saludos a Liza 27 que nos estás mirando por Ring TV Live. Corey Seager, Rookie of the Year. Yes, well, thank you for always watching us. He's ready for Alexis Rocha at TKO Boxing. That's coming up next against Marcus Beckford. There you see the LA City Hall. If you've ever watched Dragnet, for those of you older folk.
The names have been changed.